why was there a T-62 and a T-62A? What was the point of the T-62A? I mean, there were only very few T-62As built in comparison to the T-62, of which tens of thousands have been built and exported worldwide with great success. So, what's the reason behind that? Simple question, let's get to the answer. And by the way, this video kind of serves as an add-on to my previous video on why does the T-62 have a 115mm gun. So if you don't know much about the T-62's history, you might want to check out my previous video, unless you enjoy feeling as lost as a tourist in Chernobyl. Feel free to watch my other video on the T-62 first before watching this one. Or maybe don't watch either, I'm not your babysitter. You'll find the link in the video description. So hello and welcome and enjoy this video. The commander of the Soviet land forces was Marshal Vasily Ivanovich Chuikov. He was a well-known war veteran from the Battle of Stalingrad and probably thought he was immortal or just too stubborn to die. He had a reputation for being dramatic and having a bad mouth. When he found out about the British 105mm L7 gun in 1960, a gun which could penetrate basically all Soviet tanks from a great distance, he quickly reached out to Marshal Poloboryarov, who was in charge of tank forces, and other GABTU officials. GABTU was and still is the main agency of automobiles and tanks of the Ministry of Defense of the Soviet Union / now the Russian Federation. I guess the name explains what you need to know. They discussed the Object 430 tank, and his subordinates mentioned that the Object 165's D-54TS gun couldn't match the L7 in power. Desperately trying to avoid being sent to a Siberian gulag, they brought up that the Nizhny Tagil Bureau was working on a 115mm smoothbore gun. But oops, they couldn't show it to Marshal Chuikov because the tank carrying it had just broken its suspension. Chuikov went nuclear and started yelling at them, telling them not to give him any excuses about the broken suspension. According to witnesses, his words were, "I want that gun even if you have to bring it to me tied to the back of a pig." After this highly professional request, a GABTU team went to Nizhny Tagil to ask the director, Okuniev, how quickly they could start mass producing the Object 166. For those keeping track, the Object 166 was just the Object 165 with a 115mm gun. Okuniev, with the enthusiasm of a man who's already given up on life, kindly informed them that there weren't any plans to mass produce it because they were already working on a more modern vehicle, which was the Object 167. After this visit, representatives from the entire Soviet tank industry, or whatever was left of them, were summoned to Moscow for what they called discussions, but was more like an advanced course in verbal abuse. After a day of these discussions, Okuniev was convinced to begin production of the Object 166 in July 1962. They also planned to produce the T-62A, which was the Object 165, at the same time, because its gun was meant for a new tank from Kharkov, and they thought it was too expensive not to use somehow. But this plan didn't really work out, and in the end, the T-62A wasn't mass-produced in large numbers. There were several delays for different reasons, but the tank was finally shown to the public during the military parade on November 7th, when 20 vehicles from the 4th Guards Division rolled through the Red Square. The T-62 was first used in action during the 1968 occupation of Czechoslovakia. And so, the T-62 was born and became one of the most well-known and widely used Soviet tanks, kind of like the McDonald's of armored warfare. Cheap, everywhere, and mildly depressing. But it did pretty good as an export tank and shipped off to undertrained troops from third world countries who used it like it was their first day in Tank 101, usually facing armies that could actually read a manual. Despite this, the T-62 had a strong design and was a good replacement for the T-55, arguably.
Target destroyed!